Our honor to present an award to a special individual who has greatly affected the lives and careers of songwriters, because indeed this honoree has greatly affected the entire music industry. The SESAC Visionary Award is an honor that is only bestowed on real innovators of our business.
Well, I'm here with the visionary of the night. I am uber excited about that, my love. You know what? I feel like my boyfriend's back, and I want candy.
Yeah, well, you know, those are two things that everyone always needs.
Yes, exactly. A boyfriend is
a boyfriend, candy. A girlfriend, or candy. Yes, that's absolutely true. You can't lose with that. But, you know, it's a great night. It's a wonderful place, and SESAC is a great organization.
Please turn your attention to the screen as we honor Richard Gottehrer with SESAC's 2014 Visionary Award.
So I was born. I had an interesting childhood, but I'll skip right to a transistor radio. And on that little radio, I heard rock and roll. The experience of a middle-class white kid from the Bronx listening to what some people call the devil's music changed my life. I learned classical piano, but really learned how these songs were formed by listening over and over again. At that point, I thought, gee, I could do that. We worked at a publishing house where they paid us, I think, first $25 each a week. And generally, there were writing teams. In our case, there were three of us. Albums were not the thing. We were only dealing with singles, and the singles had to be less than 2.5 minutes.
My boyfriend's back and you're gonna be in trouble.
We had this great song, My Boyfriend's Back, and we recorded it. Within 6 weeks, it was number one. I mean, that fast. It just took off. And our reputation was made as producers. That led us to produce That's All I Want From You. Because at that time, the English bands and the Liverpool sound was coming in, so the three of us became the Strange Loves. In the middle, one of us, Bob, did a narration, and he did it with a British accent as a joke. Okay, didn't sound very British, but the record comes out, and the disc jockey from Virginia Beach, Virginia, calls up, and he said, if you guys would come down here, I could make this record number one. So we just said, okay, drove down. We get there, we pull into the radio station. He immediately says, everybody here thinks you're from Australia. You've got to get out to the airport and come in by plane. We pull in front of the terminal, and there's a huge signs, girls with teddy bears and jelly beans waiting to welcome Australia's Strange Loves. So we became Australian. We went back and we wrote this song called I Want Candy.
I want candy.
Who knew that this song, which was just to me a little ditty, would live and cross generations for the next 50 years and be used constantly in commercials today. I decided I wanted to do something else and went into business with another legend, Seymour Stein. And we formed at first Sire Productions and then Sire Records. In order to get product to put out, we decided to go to England to find product that wasn't being released by the large label entities. And the way we endeared ourselves to these people, we would bring with us about a dozen New York City cream cheese cakes. People went crazy for them in England, and people began to know Sire. We actually got Bob Marley to produce an album for us on Sire with Martha Velez. I stayed at Sire until 1976. Even though I wasn't there, I was proud to see the label grow. Madonna, my gosh. Depeche Mode. Depeche Mode were fantastic. And of course, Seal, the Colt. I mean, it goes on endlessly. Sire was the independent record company of the 80s and into the 90s. And it's still a great label. So I left Sire right around the time we signed the Ramones. And I started hanging around CBGBs. And it was there I signed and made the first few Blondie records. I encountered Robert Gordon, that I put together with Link Ray, and legendary Richard Hell's recordings of Blank Generation, which is an important record from this period. This is the beginning of the transition into punk music. And after that, for a number of years, I worked as an independent producer in early 1980s. Produced this group, the Go-Go's, Beauty and the Beat. But the Go-Go's were significant because they were the first all-female band to write their own songs, play all the instruments on the record, and they broke ground for a lot of people that came after them. Prior to The Orchard, independent artists had very little access. The Orchard opened the floodgates for anybody to participate. We became the distributors of all this. We recognized very early on that somehow there was this mystical thing called digital. And we asked people to give us the right to sell their music digitally as well, even though there was no place to sell it. We anticipated iTunes by 6 or 7 years. 2003 came iTunes. By then we had ourselves 150,000 tracks. We also know that the world doesn't begin and end with downloading music. We're now getting into movies. We're getting into other things. Music is still at the core, but we understand how the world changes. Always imagine. Never be satisfied with what you know. Always think of the things you don't know and what can be.
Looking at that video and hearing all that history, it's beautiful. Well, I have a special note for Richard, which I received from someone who's very special to him, your friend and longtime partner, Seymour Stein. Dear Richard, I can honestly say that without you and the groundwork that we built, neither Sire or myself could have accomplished what we did over the last 47 years. Richard, you're my very best friend, and I love you and Anita, and congratulate you both on SESAC's recognition of your lifetime achievements. Yours truly, Seymour Stein.
And now to help us with tonight's special presentation, please welcome Richard's longtime business partner, co-founder and current Vice President of International of The Orchard, Scott Cohen.
It's amazing that you're getting this award as a visionary, but to put in perspective what it really means, I can think back to a couple years after we started The Orchard. This was already 1999, when many people in this room probably still hadn't even gone on the internet. When those that did, maybe you downloaded a song or two on Napster with your blazing fast 56K modem. Where the executives in the room probably got your first emails that were printed out and laid on your desk. Sorry, no offense. It was before the BlackBerry. When you thought a phone was that thing with a dial tone and a cord? Well, this was 1999, and Richard was the first person brave enough to license music to the mobile industry and do the very first download of a song over a mobile network. 1999, a decade before the iPhone. And that was in Finland with Nokia. And if you want to hear some great stories, trust me, ask Richard about Finland. And, you know, maybe some of the greatest pleasures I've had in my life have been those dinners I've had with Richard, where over a plate of pasta, a bottle of wine, or two bottles of wine, and he tells those old stories. All right, three bottles of wine, all right, you know. he tells those great stories of the things he did, and I would say, oh, come on, Richard, tell me another one, and he'd be like, ah, that was the past. I only care about the future. And that's the kind of drive that's kept him going all these years. So I can't believe it's been nearly 20 years since I first met you, Richard. Surprisingly, you haven't aged. I became an old bald man in that time. I don't know what happened there. But I want to take just a moment to thank you. I mean, not only have you inspired so many other people, you've inspired me. You changed my life. You've been a great friend, a great business partner, and my mentor in everything I do. And I just want to thank you for that. So with this, I'm very honored to present SESAC's Visionary Award. Ladies and gentlemen, Richard Gottehrer.
You know, I want to say something, but this is too heavy to hold. listen, there are really great stories about Finland, you know. One of them involves a song, and we just don't have enough time. But if someone wants to just write me, I'm richard@theorchard.com. It's the only email address I've ever had, and the only one I'm ever going to have. And I'll tell you the story about the song. And it's really important in this present company to know that story. But I'll just start now with my notes, because I'll just keep talking if I don't look at the notes. Okay. I never thought of myself as a visionary. Really? I'm just a songwriter that stopped writing songs and needing something else to do with his time just to stay in the game. It's really true, because it all starts with a song, you know? So I became a producer, became Australian, learned about publishing, started a record company, and with each change, kept adjusting until one day, I met Scott. And together, we found ourselves in the future with The Orchard, you know? And after 17 years, The Orchard is still growing and still plays a vital part in the new world of music. Really, all I did was just ride a wave and get lucky sometimes. I really think so, okay? Because I think luck plays a lot in whatever we do. And I'm going to read this. I just wrote this, but quickly. To me, it's still all just one stream from the beginnings of the music industry as furniture stores. We were furniture, you know? Then we had to make gramophones. We had to make recordings to stick in the furniture, you know? And then we went from the gramophone to the turntable, to the 78, the 45, the 33 RBS speeds, the single, the album, the AM radio, FM radio. The first song I ever wrote to the sale through a computer on the internet. To the first download, mobile phone, iPod. And now, the views and streaming services and plays on streaming services like YouTube and Spotify. For creators, it's really no different today than it was for those that did it in the past. But I just think what we have now is a lot better. And I think the world of music, things change, everything changes, but the world of music we live in today is really, really the best. So, and I'll say this because I am an old songwriter. If someone were to consider me a visionary, I would say, forget that, consider me a songwriter. Because songwriters are the visionaries. They're the people who imagine create the things that a producer, a musician, an arranger can do something with. It's the song that we all remember and sing long after the recordings are gone. It's the song. It's important that the songwriter is nurtured, respected, and compensated fairly. Fairly. There's still some confusion about that. The deeper we go into this streaming and digital world, and it's all going to continue to change. Remember the songwriter. Remember the songwriter. Remember the songwriter. And that's about enough. I just keep saying, remember the songwriter. Thank you, SESAC. Thank you, Linda Lawrence. Thank you, my Orchard family. Scott, I share this award with you, and nothing could happen today without you. And to all my friends who came out tonight to support me, and of course, my wife, Anita. And believe it or not, today is the 37th birthday of my daughter, Zoe. She was born on 5577. Okay, and the last thing I'm going to say, it's a special thank you to somebody that a lot of people here know. I grew up in the Bronx. I know I don't sound like it. I definitely sound like I'm from London. But I grew up in the Bronx. Again, I can say I grew up in the Bronx. Yo, I grew up in the Bronx. Steven Swid was my first friend on the block. We went to grade school, junior high school together. Went away to different colleges and lost contact for a while, but we met again when he became involved with the music business. First at SBK, and then, of course, with SESAC, and built this into a really, really amazing, amazing place. So thank you, Stephen. I'm honored to accept this award, and thank you for thinking of me. All I can say now is I know where all the visions and visionaries come from. Just listen to the songs.